Thank you. A moment to get the Zoom started. Monitors on the back. All right, can you hear me downstairs okay?
Yes, we can, Your Honor.
All right. We're about to get started. All right, this is State of Wisconsin versus Nikolai, is it pronounced Miyu?
Miyu.
Miyu. 2022 CF518. Mr. Anderson and Ms. Ellenwood appear for the state. Mr. Harrelson is present. Mr. Miyu appears by video from the St. Croix County Jail. Before we take up the initial appearance, I just want to address a few things. First, we have a packed courtroom. All of you are welcome today. I do have a few requests. First, make sure your cell phones are turned off or are on silent. Please remain silent and seated if you are in a chair during these proceedings. Once this case is concluded, we will recess to allow those of you to exit who do not wish to participate in the other hearings. Earlier today, I signed a media order. Credentialed media may photograph and record today's hearing. The general public, however, may not photograph or video. That means no cell phone photography, no photography of any kind. At the victim's requests, no photography of the victims who are seated in the gallery. That means no shots, video, or still of the gallery area. I have permitted a number of people to appear by Zoom who I understand represent victim interests. You are visible to the entire courtroom. If you do not wish to be seen or photographed, you may cover your camera or disconnect it. You'll still be able to see and hear us in the courtroom. But please know that you are visible to everybody who is seated in the courtroom. Let's take up the initial appearance. Mr. Miyu, can you hear me?
Yes, sir.
Do you have a copy of the criminal complaint?
Yes, sir.
Is your address correct?
Yes, sir.
Is your date of birth listed correctly on the complaint?
Yes, sir.
You have the right to an attorney. If you cannot afford an attorney, one may be appointed for you at public expense. Did you meet with the public defender today?
Yes.
Does he qualify?
Yes.
He does not.
Does not qualify?
Does not.
The public defender tells me, Mr. Miyu, that you do not qualify for public defender representation. If you think you still may want a lawyer at public expense, you may qualify for a court-appointed attorney. It's a lot like a public defender, but you repay the county at a prescribed rate. You are certainly free to hire an attorney on your own. You may represent yourself if I am comfortable and believe that you are capable of doing so. Is it okay if the public defender helps you at least for today's hearing?
Yes.
All right. Mr. Harrelson, did you go over the complaint?
Not with Mr. Mew. I received it about 10 minutes before 1 o'clock.
Mr. Mew, I'm going to read off the charges so that you're aware of what you've been accused of doing. In count one, you've been charged with first-degree intentional homicide. That is a Class A felony. Upon conviction, you face a sentence of life imprisonment. In counts 2, 3, 4, and 5, you are charged with attempted first-degree intentional homicide. Those counts involve Class B felonies. Upon conviction, you would serve a maximum term of imprisonment not to exceed 60 years. Do you understand the charges and the maximum possible penalties?
Yes, sir.
Further reading.
He's waived.
Let's take up bond. What is the state's recommendation?
Thank you, Your Honor. The state is requesting a $500,000 cash bond. No contact with the victims listed in counts 2, 3, 4, and 5. Absolute sobriety and no use or possession of a dangerous weapon. We are asking that the court would also order a no contact with victim one, as named in the complaint, family. As the court is aware, victim one has now deceased. The state did file an identification key with the criminal complaint that we would ask be filed with the bail sheet, but kept under seal. As the court is aware, under 969.01 sub 4, considerations in setting bail. Mr. Mew apparently has no criminal record. He does not reside here in St. Croix County. It appears from my research that he has lived in Minnesota for quite some time, has no contacts or relations here in St. Croix County. It appears that he has a job that would consider him to be known to have assets. And given the seriousness of these offenses, Judge, obviously count one, facing a lifetime in imprisonment, and counts 2 through 5, also carrying significant prison time as well as high fines. We are asking the court would set that high cash bond to ensure Mr. Mew's return to court. The other considerations are based on the allegations in the complaint, as it alleges there is video, partial video, I will say, of this attack on these victims. It does appear to be violent in nature. For those reasons, we are asking for those conditions. Thank you.
Mr. Harrelson.
So, Your Honor, Mr. Mew does own his residence, so he has some permanent ties to the Prior Lake area where he lives with his wife. He is the sole provider for their household. He's lived 11 years at this last address, but in the Twin Cities since 1993. He does have bachelor's of science degrees, both in mechanical engineering and in mathematics. He's an engineer, working for Ritchie Engineering as a mechanical engineer and a tech reporter. He's responsible for designing residential, commercial, and automotive ventilation and cooling systems. He has quite a lot of education and practical on-the-job experience. He has a very stable job with Ritchie Engineering, where he's been employed for the last 16 years. He has no objection, of course, to the state's request for no contact with the victims or the family of the victim in count number one, although judging from the facts as alleged in the complaint, I have no reason to believe that he knows who they are or anything about them. This appears to have been a completely chance encounter on the river, a very unfortunate one, but he doesn't seem to have had any prior knowledge of who these individuals are, so I just ask that remaining under seal, the appropriate contact information would be provided to him so that he knows who not to reach out to. He has no objection to no possession of dangerous weapons, although I would request that a definition be provided to him. The statutory definition, off the top of my head, I don't remember what section it is where this term dangerous weapons is defined, but I would like a definition, preferably the one from the statutes, so that he knows what it is he can and cannot possess. No objection to the absolute sobriety requested. As to the $500,000 cash, I would like to remind the court that the primary purpose of Cash in setting bail is to ensure his return to court. There are, of course, a number of alternatives that the state can use, that the court can order alternatives to Cash, which can serve the same purpose. And in fact, some of those alternatives I would propose offer a greater assurance of return to court. So Mr. Mew, I've spoken with him, would not object to an ankle bracelet with GPS monitoring. Being as old as he is and no criminal history that is known, I don't see any reason to make the geographic restriction tiny, but I would ask that he be given an ankle bracelet in lieu of a high amount of cash. As to the cash, I understand why some cash is necessary to ensure that he has an interest in returning to the court. My request would be for $50,000 cash. As Your Honor is aware, cash bail in this state is not handled by percentages and bail bondsmen, but he would have to come up with that in cash, and that can be difficult for anyone, even an engineer. Now, I would suggest to him that he complete the court's application for a court-appointed attorney, so Your Honor will have some better understanding of his finances. But given the severity of the charge, I'm not entirely certain he'll be able to hire or retain his own attorney, because I have a feeling that that's going to be quite costly. So my request is $50,000 cash. Now, I would point again to the facts as alleged in the complaint that this appears to have been an unanticipated random encounter on the river. Mr. Mew was, according to the allegations, there with his wife and some friends. They were floating down the river, and he was momentarily separated from them for the purpose of looking for a lost cell phone when he and the victims in this case encountered one another. I'm sure, has read the facts of the complaint. This is not a situation where there's been premeditation for months or weeks or former contact with the victims or some prior grudge that led Mr. Mew to devise a plan for killing or injuring any of them. This is a case where something went wrong in the encounter on the river and escalated, resulting in some very unfortunate consequences. But Mr. Mew, I don't think the facts of the complaint provide any reason to believe that he will not return to court. I think $50,000 cash and an ankle bracelet with GPS monitoring is sufficient. I understand if the court wants to have him report to the Justice Support Center once a week by telephone call to verify his residence and his current employment. I understand the severity of the charges, but I think that the allegations, the way that they are in the complaint, law enforcement will have to do a lot of investigation and sorting out in this matter, but there are apparently two sides to the story, which are both presented in the complaint. In light of those and Mr. Mew's stability of employment and residence, family, I'm asking for $50,000 cash with the ankle bracelet.
You mentioned GPS bracelet. What geographic restrictions do you propose?
I don't have any information from him that he's required to travel for work, but I also don't know the location of Ritchie Engineering. My request would be that he be ordered to remain within the state of Minnesota and Wisconsin.
Ms. Ellenwood, any comment on the GPS offer?
Well, Judge, the victims, some do reside in Minnesota, and so that would be, I think, too broad of a spectrum to say you can go to the state of Minnesota when the victims are there. Perhaps if the court were to order a GPS restriction, it could be just for work and home.
There's no objection to ordering that he remain outside of some identified perimeter from whatever address it is, but he'll need to know where to stay away from.
All right, I am going to first say a few things. These are things that I've taken into consideration. One, obviously, is the nature of the alleged crimes. They're serious in nature. That is an understatement. We're dealing with a first-degree intentional homicide. It carries a maximum penalty of life in prison. We have five victims, one of whom is deceased. Four others allegedly have been seriously injured. I'm unclear about what their prognosis is, but from what I've read, I can conclude safely that this incident resulted in serious injuries to them. Mr. Miyu is not a resident of Wisconsin. He's not a resident of our county. No meaningful ties to our community have been identified other than the crime itself. He has no criminal history that anyone is aware of. He does have assets. Sounds like it consists largely of a home, perhaps other assets too. He's lived in Prior Lake since roughly 1993, from what I understand. We're dealing with a violent crime, and that is concerning. The safety of the public also factors into my decision. So I think the following bail is reasonable and appropriate, given all of those circumstances. First, I find that cash is necessary to assure Mr. Miyu's return to court, given the serious nature of these offenses, the maximum penalties that he faces, along with the absence of any ties. Cash is warranted. In my judgment, $1 million is an appropriate amount. I think that is warranted, given the fact that we have five victims with unknown prognosis, the exception of one who regretfully has been fatally injured. Conditions of bond include absolute sobriety. That may be verified through testing through the Justice Services Department on an ankle or a remote testing device. I'd like to have testing set at least four times per day. Mr. Miyu will not possess any dangerous weapons. Dangerous weapons are, or include, those identified in statute. We'll have that spelled out so that there are not any misunderstandings. Court will also order GPS monitoring. He is restricted from 1/2 mile from each of the victims' homes. He'll have no contact with any of the victims and victim one's family. Were there any conditions that I missed?
No, Your Honor.
All right. We'll go off the record. We'll have the matter scheduled for a preliminary hearing.
Your Honor, considering I wonder if we could have an attorney status conference prior to the preliminary hearing to see whether he's retained someone or needs a court-appointed attorney, because although I would like to, it seems like a good idea for his attorney to make the judgment about whether or not to waive the speediness of the preliminary hearing in order to properly prepare for that matter.
That's a good idea. Let's go off and schedule. Can we do the preliminary hearing August 12, 10 o'clock?
August 12, what time?
10.
10.
That work?
Let me just look at the law enforcement calendar, Judge. That should be fine. Thank you.
So August 12 at 10 for preliminary hearing. And then let's check in to find out the status of counsel. How about this Friday? Uh, 1:45, right after intake.
That's fine.
Right, back on. We'll have the matter scheduled for a preliminary hearing on August 12 at 10 o'clock. I'll have it set for a status conference on August 5 at 1:45. Purpose of the status conference will be to see whether or not counsel has been appointed or retained. Mr. Mayhew, if you think you are interested in the court-appointed attorney, please fill out the application immediately. That way we can review your eligibility and find a qualified attorney to take your case. You may retain counsel on your own if you prefer, and we'll talk about which direction you plan to go on August 5 at 1:45. If you do bail out, you must be present for all future court hearings. Failure to appear may result in a warrant for your arrest. Mr. Harrelson.
Judge, just to correct the record on one point, I think you mentioned he had been resident at Prior Lake since 1993. What I meant to say was he had been there for the last 11 years, but in the Twin Cities metro area since 1993.
Okay. I misheard you.
Thank you.
Anything else, Ms. Ellenwood?
No, thank you.
All right, that's all. We stand in recess. Thank you.